Hello everyone. This lesson will cover a type of block cipher design called substitution-permutation networks. In this lesson, you will learn about the structure and the building blocks of such ciphers, write a substitution-permutation network-based cipher yourself, encrypt and decrypt with it, and learn its advantages compared to other cipher designs. A substitution-permutation network, or SPN or SP network, is a type of underlying design of block ciphers alongside the Feistel network. SP networks are used in many modern block cipher algorithms, such as the United States Symmetric Encryption Standard IAS, Ukrainian Standard Kalina, Russian Standard Kuznechik, and many other ciphers, including three-way, present, cipher, shark, and square. A substitution-permutation network is a series of linked transformations that take a block of the plaintext and the key as inputs and apply several alternating rounds or layers of substitution, called S-boxes, and permutation, called P-boxes, to produce the ciphertext block. Claude Shannon has identified desirable properties for secure ciphers, confusion and diffusion. Confusion is intended to make the relationship between the key and the ciphertext as complex as possible. Diffusion refers to rearranging or spreading out the bits in the message so that any redundancy in the plaintext is spread out over the ciphertext. In SP networks, a substitution in a round adds confusion to the encryption process, whereas a permutation adds diffusion. The encryption is carried out in multiple rounds to make mappings between input and output bits more complicated. Each round applies a substitution and a permutation to the input. Like in this code snippet, the substitution part is done by the Caesar cipher and the permutation by the permute function. At each round, a round key is derived from the initial secret key and added to the ciphertext. Usually, the round keys are added in by XOR or modular addition. Decryption is done by simply reversing the process, using the inverses of the substitution boxes and the permutation boxes, and applying the round keys in the reverse order. Most ciphers based on SP network follow Kirchhoff's principle. Every detail about the algorithm is published, including the S boxes and the P boxes used. This may seem to be a security threat because reversing the encryption is trivial to an attacker this way. However, it is not. Mixing in the key adds great uncertainty and allows one to achieve confidentiality even when the enemy knows the system. In this example, you will be constructing a 10-round substitution permutation network with a 32-byte block size and key size. The algorithm will consist of plaintext partition and padding, key scheduling, substitution layer of S-boxes, and permutation layer of P-boxes. These all operations will be combined into encryption and decryption transformations, and together with the key generation function, will form a cryptosystem. A text message can simply be encoded as byte values of the characters it consists of. If the message is longer than the required block size, which is 32 bytes, it should be split into blocks. If the last block is shorter than needed, it should be padded. Recall that even if the plaintext splits into blocks evenly, it should be padded with the whole block of constant byte values, in our case 32, 32, 32, the whole array, to avoid ambiguity during decryption. Define a function to encode the message, split it into blocks, and pad. Here, two-character code encodes the message into byte values of characters. The pad value variable defines how many bytes should be added to the last block. Then, in the case a plaintext length is divisible by the block size, a new block of constant values 32, 32, 32 is added. And finally, the whole thing is partitioned into even blocks. Let's test it on the plaintext of different lengths. In this example, the last and the only block is 14 bytes shorter than needed 32, so it is padded with a 14-byte value 14 times. In here, the last block is 9 bytes shorter, so it's added with 9-byte value 9 times. After decryption, the padding has to be removed to get back the plain text. The decoder looks at the last byte, which is always a padding byte, be it 1, 2, or 32, and removes as many bytes as needed. Let's try decoding some padded bytes. Here the decoder successfully removes the 14s in the first message and the 9s in the second message, and decodes them back to readable strings. The initial secret key for the cipher should be 32 bytes long. You can simply generate a list of 32 random byte values using random integer. In practice, special cryptographically secure random number generators are used. The procedure that calculates all the round keys from the initial secret key is called the key schedule. Some ciphers use simple algorithms such as splitting the key into multiple parts and then using them repeatedly. And others use complicated algorithms to avoid simple relationships between the secret key and the round keys. Here in each round you can derive a round-specific key by rotating the previous key 2 bytes to the left. The 10-round SP network in our example will need 12 round keys, one for the initial XOR, 10 for 10 main rounds, and one for final XOR. Define a key scheduling function to get all 12 keys needed. Let's check the order of keys we'll be used in, derived from a list of bytes 1 to 32. You can see that every next key is shifted 2 places to the left compared to the previous round key. So for encryption, they will be used in this order, and for decryption, the round keys will be used in the reverse order. Next on, you will need to define the main mechanisms of an SP network, substitution and permutation boxes. The S-box substitutes an input block of bytes within another block of bytes. The substitution is similar to a classic substitution cipher. It has to be a one-to-one invertible mapping, which is necessary for decryption. Usually, when a cipher is published, it contains the recommended S-boxes for use. Some ciphers use one S-box on the whole block or use multiple different S-boxes on smaller parts of the input block. For example, 4 boxes per 8 byte subblocks of the 32 input block, or 8 boxes for 4 bytes. Let's generate a random S-box. During encryption, the S-box will substitute the input byte value according to its position. Let's define the S-box as a lookup table. This table defines the substitution rules according to this particular S-box and would be different if a different S-box was used. So here, if the input byte value was 1, it would be substituted for this value, 2 for this one, and so on. During decryption, the substitution will be simply inverted. The permutation layer, the P-box, then takes the outputs of all the S-boxes of one round, was it one or multiple, permutes the bits and fits them into the S-boxes of the next round. Let's generate a random permutation of 32 bytes for a P-box and find its inverse permutation to use for decryption. The encryption and decryption are performed in multiple rounds. For encryption, each round function is a sequence of round key addition, here with bit XOR, substitution, as a lookup into X boxes, and permutation, applied to a block of data. For decryption, the same operations are used in reverse order, and P boxes and S boxes are inverted as well. Let's test if that function makes a round trip. Generate a random key, define the test message block, and check if encryption and subsequent decryption gives you back the same input block. And indeed it does. Finally, you can combine the steps into an encryption transformation. Take notice of the final substitution and key addition after the 10 rounds. The encryption transformation takes a string plain text with a 32-byte list key, encrypts it in 10 rounds, applies final substitution, and outputs the string ciphertext. For the code, it encodes the message into bytes, splits it into blocks, and pads with the message encode function we defined earlier, then derives 12 round keys from the initial one, applies round function 10 times, and to finish up, applies another substitution as seen on the diagram and XORs in the last round key. Note that by simply using math to encrypt every input block, we are effectively using the electronic codebook block mode, which is the simplest one. Let's see if it works. Well, this output is quite illegible. The decryption transformation takes a string ciphertext with a 32-byte list key, decrypts the final substitution in the 10 rounds, and outputs back a string plain text. It encodes the encrypted message back into character bytes and splits into blocks, schedules the 12 round keys from the initial one in the reversed order, strips away the final substitution, and applies the inverted round function 10 times. To finish up, it removes the padding bytes with message decode and gives you back the string text. Let's try encrypting and decrypting some messages. Well, our example one works. You could try a few more. An important advantage of SP networks compared to Feistel networks is inherent parallelism. They allow for very efficient encryption on CPUs with multiple execution units. It can be computed faster than Feistel networks on such CPUs. The relative simplicity of round function is less prone to implementation errors. Confusion and diffusion provide resistance to known cryptanalytical methods, and the key sizes ensure long-term security against brute force attacks. Now that you have learned how to construct a substitution-permutation network cipher, in the next lesson you will learn about the inner workings of another common cipher design, the Feistel networks.